in the angelic ranking, in all of creation, only man could reveal the dimensions of God. And Lucifer had perceived this thing, so he wanted to enter into it. I will exalt my throne above this.
So the dimension of power Paul was speaking about is the resurrection power. There are two broad dimensions of God's power. There's the creative dimension and there's the resurrection dimension. The creative dimension power is the power that gives life, is the power that creates. But what is created can be destroyed. What is born can be killed. But you see, the resurrection power is a power that lives above destruction. It's a power that lives above death. So this dimension of power Paul is speaking about here is the highest dimension of power there is in God. However, he said the operation of this power is subject to illumination. Number one, that God may grant you wisdom. The word is Sophia, the ability to analyze truth, the ability to cognitively interact with facts and make meaning out of them. And then number two, he spoke about revelation, is the apocalypse, is the ability to open you up into realms, is the unveiling. So God brings you into realms of possibilities. And then number three, he spoke about enlightenment. The word is fortizo. It means light is shed upon. And then he said you come into epignosis, experience. So all of these are dimensions of illumination that makes you enjoy the hope of your calling, the riches available to the saints, and the resurrection power. That means every one of us seated here is supposed to walk in the fullness of the hope of our callings. We are supposed to walk in the riches of the inheritance of the saints in light, and we are supposed to function in the resurrection power that brought Jesus back from the dead. But it's at the mercy of our illumination. If you don't have wisdom, revelation, enlightenment, and knowledge, he said you can't walk in them. And so triumphant living is available to us all. The question is, what is the degree of your illumination? And the key to illumination is the proceeding word of God. When the word of God begins to come to a man, light begins to come to that man. The Bible speaking in John chapter 1 from verse 1 to verse 4, talking about the Logos, the excellency of the Logos. It said, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. It said, the same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him. Without him was not anything made that was made. And he said, in him was life, and the life was the light. So when the Word comes into you, it produces light to you. And so anybody who wants to function triumphantly must build a technology and a receptacle for receiving the proceeding word. Find anybody who is dominating this realm. He will always tell you, God told me. I found one major key for impact in life. God told me. If you can receive the proceeding word, there's no way your life will not be impactful. That's why Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded from the mouth of God. A Christian who wants to live triumphantly must do business with the word until the word begins to come to him. If the word is not yet coming to you, everything you see is a mirage. The Bible said this realm was created by the word. All things were made by him. Without him was not anything made that was made. So anything that does not come to you by the word is a mirage. Over time, it will vanish. But if it is the word that revealed it, if it's the word that gave it, if it's the word that produced it, even if the whole hell is unleashed, you will still stand and nothing can take it away from you. Because the word is what sustains this realm. This is why triumphant living is a function of our interaction with the proceeding word of God. And I can tell you, many Christians don't receive the word of God. You know why? Receiving the word of God is a ministry. And if you want to get to that point where you receive the word of God, you must submit yourself to the ministry of the word. In Acts chapter 6 verse 4, the apostles were speaking. And they said, we'll not give ourselves to tables. He said, we'll give ourselves to prayer and to the ministry of the word. They had a word to conquer. So they knew human favor is good, it's not enough. They knew every other forces that men subscribe to is good, but it's not enough. The word must come to us. And so one thing we must commit ourselves to is prayer and the ministry of the word. So every day, the word must keep coming. So long as the word is coming, triumphant living is a must. Nothing can stop it. So a Christian who wants to make impact in life must understand the ministry of the word. And there are three things about the ministry of the word. Number one is engagement. Number two is receiving. And number three is administration. You must know how to engage the word. You must know how to receive the word. And you must know how to administer the word. If you can meet this triangle, you will discover that it will be natural for you to be triumphant. And there are four basic ways of engaging the word. Number one is by reading. Number two is by studying. Number three is by meditation. And number four is by obedience. These are the four basic biblical ways of engaging the word. In 1 Timothy 4:13, Paul speaking, he said, "Until I come, give attendance to reading, to exhortation, and to doctrine." He said, "Give thyself wholly to these things, that thy profiting may be made manifest to all." He didn't say so that you might prosper. You must prosper if you do it. But if you give yourself to it, he said, your profiting may be what? Made manifest to all. So the first thing Paul highlighted is what? Reading. Give attendance to reading. If you want the word to begin to come to you, you must first of all make a practice of reading the word. In the days of the fathers, they sat down to read. I was studying the books of Kenneth E. Hagin, and he said how he will sit down reading different versions. They don't even have the privilege we have now, where you can just carry your phone and you type different versions at the same time they are coming up. They will gather 7 Bibles and they are reading. His son said he will go to school. He will be reading. He's returning. He's still there reading. And he's reading till night. And they stayed there. After a while, you now discovered you read Logos. But eventually, the manifestation your life commands does not look like Logos. You show up in a place, the dead comes back to life. You are talking. People's lives are changing. Suddenly, your fame spread abroad. And they are wondering what is going on. When the word saturates you, it will flow out. And when the word begins to flow out, creation is commanded, because it's the flow of the word that creates. So opportunities can be created. Favor can be created. Outcomes, any outcome at all that is encapsulated in the word can begin to find expression. But the problem is that many are not reading. This is a distracted generation. You carry your phone, you sit there 7 hours, you have watched only pictures that has no impact on your destiny. And then you are hoping that you will triumph in a world of demons. The Bible called the devil the god of this world. When you see a Christian making impact, it means he held the devil to a standstill. The devil hates it, but there's nothing he can do about it. By the power of the Holy Ghost, he enforces dominion. That's how we rule here. This world is full of cruelty and darkness. Is this a world to sit down watching movies for 4 days in 1 week and you hope to make impact because you think it's a function of luck and chance? When demons show up, you will discover that the thing you know passively cannot address their realm. Give attendance to reading. Number two, he said, give attendance to exhortation and doctrine. That's the compilation of studying. When you are studying, you take time to read in depth, to find out context. And then you also listen to those who know it better and hear their perspective. When you follow exhortation and doctrine, then you have a robust study. And that's the second way to engage the word. When you engage the word in studying, you will discover you begin to have authority. Reading will give you perception, but studying will give you understanding. And in understanding, there's authority. And then you don't stop there. You now go into meditation. In Joshua chapter 1 verse 8, it said, "This book of the law shall not depart no longer out of thy eyes. It's now out of thy mouth." So what you have seen, what you have heard, what you have studied, now talk it. Now eat it. It is in meditation that the word is made flesh. So when a Christian wants to be triumphant, he makes a practice of talking the word. And not talking it when he has to preach to others. Talking it to himself. See the problem with us? When we come to face a congregation, we become eloquent preachers. But when we wake up at home, we don't talk the word to ourselves. When we go to the place of prayer, we don't talk the word to ourselves. And because we don't eat the word does not become flesh in us. Meanwhile, the glory in the word is manifested when the word is made flesh. He said, and the word became flesh, and we beheld his glory. So if you want the glory of the word to manifest, the word must become flesh. And the way the word becomes flesh is by talking it to yourself. When you are talking the word to yourself, you are eating it. And if you eat it, after a while, the aroma will flow out of you. This is the practice of triumphant living. Sit with that word, read it, meditate on it, chew it for a long time. After a while, you will discover that even your molecular structure begins to change. Because as the word enters you, it will inundate you first. It will transform you first. Then it will begin to invigorate you so that you can change your world. Eat it. That's what meditation is about. And when you do that, after a while, then the word now begins to talk to you. That's where obedience is required. Because as you are engaging the word, a point will come. The word will now begin to engage you. So you wake up and God speaks to you. Go and give that man 2 million. You say, Lord, is that a demon? I just made 2.1 million. You didn't ask me to give the one on top. Is it the two I should give? I thought you said love your neighbor as yourself. I didn't read love your neighbor more than yourself. How can I do this? And God will keep quiet. If you don't obey, you won't move. And God's servant has dealt with obedience extensively, so I'm not going there. But the other side of obedience is the blessing. That's why in Joshua 1:8, he said, when you comply to doing what is written therein, he said, then. He didn't say, God will make your way prosperous. He said, you will make your way prosperous and you will have good success. That's where triumphant life comes in. And so you must master the art of obeying the word. So if you engage the word engages you. And if the word begins to engage you, then you begin to obey the word. This is the first dimension of the ministry of the word. Now, as the word begins to come to you and you begin to see the manifestations that follow, then what you do now is that you sharpen your receptacle to receive more. That's where the art of receiving the word comes in. And it takes a lot of spiritual intelligence to keep receiving the word of God. Some has to do with virtue, some has to do with prayer. But it will take some spiritual engagement to continually receive the word. For example, look at James chapter 1 verse 21 and see what the Bible said. One of the ways of receiving the word. Now that you obeyed the word, you saw an outcome. You now begin to position yourself to keep receiving. It said, wherefore, lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness and receive with meekness the engrafted word. So now you are obeying the word. After a while, there's a demand for meekness. So there are dimensions of the word that will not come to you until you sustain a posture of humility. Because when you become high-minded, the word will stop coming. You now discover that reading, meditation takes you to a level. But now God wants your character to become the receptacle through which the word will be caught. And so you discover that you will migrate from the physical engagement, it will become a transformational thing. And so when people offend you or when people try to undermine you, instead of responding in the flesh, you now know that when you activate flesh, flesh will dwarf your senses. So because of the word, you would have shown them that you are a big man. I have 7 cars. I just decided to throw here. Now that you want to show up, I would have brought 1 car that is worth $2 million. You want to act. You now remember, it's the receptacle of meekness that received the word. So you will say it's well. You will celebrate them, let them go. Because you can't but depend on the word that comes to you. Now, meekness has become an antenna. And you will need that antenna to be working for you to make progress. Are you seeing the way God works? So as God is making you triumphant, God is also transforming you at the same time. So after a while, your blessings will now look like you. And when they see you, they will not just see what God has done for you. They will now see the God that is in you. Because eventually, you would have become like your God.
And all of that is tied to receiving.
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 When people are living triumphantly, they are masters when it has to do with the world. Their realm is illuminated. You can't walk in darkness and prosper. Job 29 verse 4, he said, as I was in the days of my youth, when the secrets of God was upon my tabernacle, he said, by light I walked through darkness. So when you see men prosper, regardless of circumstances, there are words coming to them. There are words. Before this government came into power, some persons already received word. Because they don't receive their own news from NTA. They don't receive their own news from AIT. They receive their own news from heaven. And God would have forewarned them 2 years before now. Better start doing this because something is about to change. And when things begin to happen, they now say, oh, Lord, this is why you said this. Now we know. But there are some people that will always be taken unawares because they don't hear from heaven. This is why, although drums of oil has been poured on them, but life has not gone anywhere. And so please, let's not, the olive oil too should be managed. Let's manage the olive oil. Glory to God. But these are sure ways of living triumphantly. Engage the world. Ask yourself, how frequent do you hear God? If you don't hear God frequently, you are taking a lot of risk. Because it's a danger to be stranded and God is not speaking in the face of the circumstances of life. But when you hear God, you become a master of circumstances. The ministry of the word. There must be illumination. He said, thy word is a light unto my path and is a lamp unto my feet. I keep hearing, and as I keep receiving it, I keep seeing. I know where to go. I know what step to take. And my life is an unending success. And so when you find a man who is functioning by the word, you will think, oh, this thing God's done, what else is remaining? He is the definition of God's blessings. So there will always be else, because it's from glory to glory. His path becomes like the path of the just man that shines brighter and brighter unto the perfect day, from one level of glory to another level of glory. But the secret is the illumination that he keeps receiving. You look at the life of Isaac. He wanted to become smart. And when people were moving to Egypt, he followed them, the jackpot generation. And God told him, stay still in Gerar. This is the land where your blessing is. Imagine if you went to Egypt. But in that land, the Bible said, the man waxed strong and became great and exceeding great until the Philistines envied him. So one man can be so big that the whole nation envies him. He was bigger than the nation. But only one instruction made it happen. Stay still in Gerar. It didn't sound spiritual. It didn't sound lofty. Stay still in Gerar. This land, you will be blessed. That's all. Eventually, he became bigger than the whole nation. If you are missing proceeding words, there will be problem. Because it doesn't matter where the word meets you. Wherever the word finds you, it will take you to where you ought to be. The Bible said concerning Joseph, Psalm 105 verse 17, he was in prison. He said, until the time that his word came. So it's when your word comes that your triumphant life begins. He said he was bound in fetters. He was put in chains. The chain is not your problem. The problem is the barrenness in hearing the word. If the word comes, you will see how helpless the chains are. If the word comes, you will see how helpless the fetters are. He said, until the time that his word came, the word of the Lord tried him. And he said, the king sent for to lose him. How did the king come into the scene? The word has come. And instantly, a man leaves prison and becomes a teacher of senators. A man leaves prison and becomes the keeper of the king's house. And you are wondering, what structure is that? You can't explain it. The word is the structure. You say, I thought you are supposed to go to the school of the Egyptian scholars for 7 years. I thought you are supposed to go to school of leadership for 14 years. When I was hearing the word, I was schooling. And the moment the word came, all my classes were completed. And so you can move from prison to palace, depending on what you have heard. I'm telling you, people are running helter-skelter, crying, talking about chains. The chain is not the problem. The fetters is not the problem. The problem is that you are not hearing. News is coming from heaven. The moment you start catching yours, you will discover that your progression becomes constant. You catch it. You catch it. The word is catalambano. You catch it. Because frequencies are passing. As we are sitting in this room, frequencies are passing. Television rays are passing here. Waves of radio. The reason you are not hearing them is because this one is not designed to hear radio wave. But when you have an antenna, you will discover that there's so much. They are talking all over now. The space is choked. And so if you want to go forward, you must awaken your antenna. And the way to awaken your antenna is to engage the world. Engage the world. Engage the world until the world begins to come to you. You are sleeping. A word comes. You wake up. You write it. You sleep. And you'll discover that you can be sleeping and prospering. Because anytime the word comes, prosperity is attached. Why somebody else has toyed? He said, we have toyed all night. It's not about toiling, sir. The realm is regulated in a particular way. I know you have toyed all night. I know you are trained fishermen. You have experience. This is your river. But I am the word of life. Cast, move, cast into the deep. I say, okay. We know this business. Oh, we have done this since we were children. But according to thy word, follow the word and see the difference. And when they launch to the deep, their eyes, I'm wondering what they look like in the face. Is this not the ocean current that we mastered for 20 years? The word has come. I created the ocean. I created the fish. When I speak, everything aligns. So it's not about the toiling. It's about the word. It's about the word. You want to be triumphant? Pay the price to hear the word. Pay the price. Pay the price. When you hear, you will be triumphant. That's the key. And one thing this conference will do for you is to open your ears. Amen. If your ears are open from this conference, you will be shocked what will happen to you in 3 months. You will be so shocked. Some of you will not be able to believe it, but it will be too real to deny. If your ears are opened, you will be shocked. Until his word came, he said, the word of the Lord tried him. Illumination. I wish I had time to show you 5 levels of illumination. As you start doing business with the world, the first thing that will happen to you is that your mentality will be upgraded. That's the first dimension of illumination. Because some of us, Satan may not directly be involved. The problem is the village where we came from. Say thank you. You say no. Men don't say thank you. Sir, you will die there. Just say thank you, sir. I'm grateful. You say no. If I say thank you, they are trying to intimidate me. You are the one who thinks nobody has your time. Everybody is facing his destiny and pursuing his life. It's your smallness that is making you think the whole world is looking at you. Who is intimidating who? Say thank you. Be grateful. Go away. Say no way. Man, how can a man like me, man like you, and you have not eaten since yesterday? So when the word comes, the first illumination is to upgrade your mentality. The word is gnosis. Gnosis. It begins to help you to think at a higher frequency, at a godly frequency. So you see, you think better. That's why in 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 5, it says, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge. That's gnosis. It's as you are interacting with the knowledge of the law of the world that your mind starts being upgraded. So you analyze better, you think better, you reason better, you become more productive. Some persons are not going anywhere because fear have crippled them. Fear. They fear of the unknown. They say, I don't know. The first person who started in our family, he died at 35. The second person died at 34. Now me, I'm 33. So I don't know if I should start something. Relax. I know you came from that family, but you also came from Christ. For whoever is in Christ Jesus is a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. So I'm not thinking what's happening to my bloodline. I'm thinking what's happening to those in my class. And I don't only have blood family. I also have kingdom family. And the last time I checked, Moses made impact.
Paul the apostle made impact. Barnabas made impact. Peter made impact. And they said, no one of them were killed. They laid down their lives. Because in the family where I come from, you can't kill us. This commandment we have received from the Father, we have the power to lay down our lives and to take it up again. You can't kill me. That's a better way to think. He said, but everybody is poor, not me. He said, Christ, rich as he was, he became poor so that you through his poverty might be made rich. I'm rich in Christ. He said, bad luck. We don't function by luck. No, we make things happen. These signs shall follow them that believe. In my name shall they cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. If they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. If they tread upon scorpions and serpents, they cannot be hurt. We are invincible. What is bad luck? I say, we don't know. Something might happen. Things don't happen to us. We make things happen. We make things happen. He said, as the wind bloweth, thou listest not from whence it cometh or where it goeth, so are they that are born by the Spirit of God. My mentality is changed. He said, I don't know. Nobody from our village has attained this height before. Who is talking about your village? He said, not many days from now, you shall receive the Holy Ghost and power. And you shall be witnesses unto me in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and to the uttermost part of the world. If it is not yet global, it has not started. If I'm selling pure water, it will be global. If I'm selling clothes, it will be global. If I'm sewing dresses, it will be global. If I'm doing ministry, it will be global. Because it's to the uttermost part of the earth. Makarade aragata. If not for the world, how can an Otukwa boy think like that? But when I check the world, I know it's got to be global. Because when he commissioned them, he said to the uttermost part of the world. I know it's got to be global. And today, you walk into a palace and you shake kings and you are not intimidated. Why? Because he said, Gentiles shall come to thy light. He said, kings shall come to the brightness of thy rising. So I expect kings to come. I'm not surprised when they come. It's a natural thing that should happen. Gentiles will come to your light. Kings will come to the brightness of your rising. So when the kings start coming, you'll say, wow, then the light is becoming brighter. I will make it even much more brighter. That's the word. Listen, don't let anything you are doing be limited to Abuja. Instead, it's to the uttermost part of the world. Think the globe. You know what Isaiah 60:15 said? He said, you were a desolate land. He said, no man walked through you. He said, but I have made you an eternal excellency, the joy of many generations. Somebody looked at me and said, wow, these are the men for the season. I say, sir, we are not the men for the season. Our legacy will outlive us. We will live for many generations. The impact is for many generations. Don't make the mistake of thinking we are about to rise and fall. We don't shine and go off. He said, the path of the just man is as a shining light. It shines brighter and brighter unto the perfect day. I know my tomorrow will be greater than my today. Look at me very well. This is the list of me you will see. Check me out tomorrow. I'll be better. 1,000 times better. 1,000,000 times better. Because the path of the just man is as a shining light. It shines brighter and brighter. To change your mentality. You preach a message. They say this message is great. Tell them. It's those coming in the next 50 years that will appreciate the message. Because the older, the fresher. They say, this is your company. See, there's a mentality you must have. Check the nations that received the gospel 100 years ago. They open an eatery. The eatery has been there for 150 years. Why do you think we start things here? It ends after 15 years, 20 years. Because the mind has not been doctored. We think failure. We think it too much. So it impacts on what we do. But when you leave the world, walk on you thoroughly. This is why you can't even have the time to compete. You are too sure of what God has given you. You are too sure. Anything you touch will prosper. There's no room for competition. You are doing well. Thank God for you. I celebrate you, but I'm facing my own track. He said, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor is seated in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is on the law of the Lord. On this law doth he meditate day and night. He is like the tree planted by the rivers of living waters. He produces his fruit in his season. Nothing about me fails. It's a mentality. He came from the world. Nobody would have taught me that except from the world. Except from the world. And as you are walking in it, it's just walking, it's just walking, and you are just living a glorious life, triumphing from one level to another. I prophesy over someone, it's from glory to glory. Sit down for a moment. My God, put your fears behind you. Those fears came from the wrong information that you were given and you have meditated on for a long time. Meditate on the word and see the glory that comes out of you. And that's just the first level, mental upgrade. And there are four other levels. There is the level of idol. In idol, the knowledge is not just mental upgrade. You become aware. So there is a dimension that the word brings to you. You just start becoming aware. Because what is loaded into you, if you know it, you will live in this realm. What do you think is rapture? Rapture is transfiguration. You are upgraded to your zenith. This earth can't keep you. You will vaporize. You don't just have light, you are light. The more you know, the more you become like him. And if you allow it, a point will come, this material body will be dematerialized. Paul said, we groan earnestly that we may be clothed with our tabernacle that is of heaven. So Paul knew that there's a level we'll get to, we'll wear it, and we will go. That's what you carry. So when the Holy Ghost is upgrading you by the word, a time comes when you start becoming aware. You just become aware that your hand is curative. If you lay hands on the sick, they recover. If you lay hands on a business, it will prosper. You just become aware. It was there all the while, but you become aware. Because now the world is doing something on your inside. You just, it's called idol. 2 Corinthians 5:17, he said, whoever is in Christ Jesus is a new creature. He said, all things are passed away. Behold, that's the key word. Become aware that all things have become new. It's a level of illumination. When the world starts coming to you, you discover that your life starts upgrading as you start becoming aware. And the more frequent you become aware, the faster your upgrade will be. I was hearing, listening to Oropko. He said he prayed for the sick, things were not working. And he had four encounters. And after those four encounters, he sat down one day in his parlor and he just became aware that he was anointed. And he also became aware that the power of God was in his hand. If he senses that power, whatever they call your ailment, when he's done preaching, he will sit down. I don't need atmosphere. My hand is the atmosphere. If it lays it on you, you must be healed. But all of that was tied to become aware. In 1 John 5:11-13, he said that God has given us eternal life. He said the life is in the Son. He said whoever has the Son has life. He said these things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God that you may know. The word know is idol. Become aware. Somebody sitting here, you just become aware that you are a millionaire. And you will be shocked how your business will shift. I'm telling you, you just become aware that you are a global coach and the ministry will shift. You just become aware that you are a global apostle and the ministry will shift. All of that is what the world does. You have too much in you. The problem is awareness level is low. Have you carried a comb before and you are looking for it? The comb is in your hand. You are looking for it. You are angry with everybody, but the comb is here. Then suddenly you become aware. Somebody will become aware. And you don't have to be 50 to become aware. You don't have to be 80 to become aware. You can become aware in the university. You can become aware at 21 and start shaking your world at 21. and you can become aware even at 90, and they say, you're about going to heaven, you say, we go nowhere. There is so much to do, and we must finish before we go. We must finish. This vessel must be emptied before we leave this realm. I must finish my course. And if I have not finished, I can't die. And because of that awareness, death can stay somewhere. Death, even death goes back. Did you not read about Simeon? The guy could not die because he became aware that he was a custodian in his generation. The moment he carried Jesus, he said, now my eyes have seen the salvation of the Lord. I can go in peace. That means death came and went back because he became aware. You are 80 years old. Who told you you will die? When you are aware that there's a nation that has not yet been blessed, death will have to wait until that assignment is fulfilled. When God wants to upgrade you and make you triumphant, the word makes you become aware. And somebody will become aware of the next level. Triumphant living. Triumphant. Triumphant. Don't allow the devil to deceive you and choke you with anxiety. Oh, my music ministry is finished. It doesn't finish. Nothing about us finishes. The God who created us does not finish. And it's not only heaven, it's in us. He said, this is the mystery of the age. Christ in you, the hope of glory. So our life is from glory to glory. We don't finish. Nothing finishes. In fact, when our assignment is over, we carry the residue as an inheritance. Hand it over to the next generation. Finish? What does finish mean? Not in my own life. Sit down. God bless you. It's a body. See, these things are my contemplations. They are my contemplations. And it's my body, it's my prayer that the next generation will catch it earlier. I want to see boys of 15 years pack out stadia. You come to a stadium, they say there's a revival meeting. And you say, who is the preacher? Then you see a 15-year-old boy walk out and say, the Holy Ghost sent me. That you will know that this is God. They have enough intelligence to work the administration. They have enough power to raise the dead. And they are direct, because out of the mouth of babes and sucklings, he said, thou hast ordained strength. And until we come to this level, there will be no much impact in Africa. Become aware. And there is epignosis, there is ginosko, and there is dokimazo. But I don't have time. Levels of illumination. You move from gnosis to idol to epignosis to ginosko and to dokimazo. At the level of epignosis, you experience. You are not just having punctuations. No, you live in that realm. I can become aware that God wants to heal in the service, and I come with audacity. But I can be walking in the realm of healing, and I know I have the tangibility of it. That's epignosis. So I can decide that tomorrow is healing service because I have it tangibly. And that's a realm the world can bring you to. That's why in 2 Peter 1 verse 3 and 4, the Bible said, according as his divine power hath given us. It didn't say he will give us. He has already given us all things that pertains to life and godliness through the epignosis of him that has called us to glory and virtue. So the experience causes you to live perpetually in the glory realm. You have it in its tangibility. It's your daily experience. That's where the fathers of faith got to, and they became custodians. So a man wants to go to heaven. He knows the day he's going. As if that's not enough, he says, go and get me a savory venison. I want to eat so that my soul can bless you. He knows he has the blessing. I have it. I'm not hoping it will happen. Give me something to eat. And the moment he ate, he started talking. And he said some things that defied the law of economics. He said, my son, the smell of my son is like a field that the Lord has blessed. He said, I bless you with the dew of heaven. Where is the dew of heaven? When did you become a possessor of heaven? He knows he has it. He knows. And that one also matures. And he said, gather around me, you sons of Jacob. I will tell you what will befall you. I'm not blessing you. I'm shaping your future. I have enough authority to do that. He said, Reuben, you are the beginning of my strength. But as unstable as water, you will not prosper. That means you are supposed to be full of excellence.
but I change it. And then another person comes many years later in the name of Moses. He said, let Reuben live and not die. People are changing destinies of generations by talking. One said, Reuben will not prosper. Another one said, Reuben, prosper. Because where he went to and spoke, I too have gone there. So I can determine the outcome in my own generation. Experience. And do something. Possess something. The scepter will not depart from Judah until Shiloh comes. Neither the lawgiver from in between his feet. How can you talk like this? Are you not aware that Jesus too is coming? So he determined the lineage that Jesus will come from. Because of epignosis. And this is what God wants every Christian to have. See, all of us must be known after a dimension. Let them know that you have wisdom. You have power. You have utterance. So anytime the body of Christ is looking for a dimension, they go to you straight and it's available. A nation was dying in economic turmoil, drought, nothing was anywhere. The king was hopeless. Women were eating their children. And when they knew there's no law of economics that work, they said, go and fetch Elijah. How did they know he can do something? And they came. The guy didn't raise an eyebrow. He said, go and tell the king by this time tomorrow, a cup of barley will be sold for one shekel. What does he know? Do you know what it means to change the economy of a nation? He knows something. When you enter epignosis, your life becomes an excellent flow of an eternal river. And this is what the world can make out of every one of us. You don't have to be a prophet. You just have to be born of the world and allow the world live out its protocol through you. They can tell you your business will fail. Tell them, no, it can't. I heard something. I know something. I know something. And what I know, based on what I know this business can't fail. I was told it can't. You know it. That's the Christian life. Let me push forward a bit and touch one more point because of time. The first spiritual force for triumphant living is illumination. See, refuse to live in darkness. Be illuminated. And the key is the word. Engage the word until the word becomes a light to you. Engage it. Christianity is not a religion. It's divinity expressed through humanity. God lived out through a mortal vessel. God lived out through a mortal vessel. And there are protocols that govern it. The second is faith. When I study the excellency of faith, sir, it humbles me. I was teaching them in church 2 days ago, and I showed them how that the summary of the Old Testament is the work of faith. In Hebrews chapter 11, they literally began to point out every patriarch that shook their generation. And you hear, by faith, by faith, by faith, by faith. You will study that script to assume you are a patriarch because you came first. He has no regard for who came first. So Adam was not there. He said, by faith, Abel. Where is Adam? The very first man is not there. Where is Adam? By faith, Abel offered up a more excellent sacrifice. They knew something. That to rule this realm, you must tap into the frequency of faith. And a point came in verse 32 and 33 when the whole Old Testament manifestation was summarized. It was also summarized on the basis of faith. He said, time will fail me to speak of Gideon, of Barak, of Jephthah, of Samuel, of David, and the prophets who through faith subdued kingdoms. This is the summary of the manifestation of the Old Testament. Obtained righteousness. Shut the mouth of lion, quench the violence of fire. Weak men were made valiant in fight, and they put to flight the armies of the alien. Every manifestation in the Old Testament, it was tied to faith. So there's something about faith that we must know if we must triumph. And if you start studying faith, you will discover that the excellency of faith insists that you must walk in faith. In fact, there are six major things about faith that makes faith a must. Number one, in Hebrews 11:6, it says, without faith, it's impossible to please God. That means prayer is useless without faith. Give is useless without faith. Fellowship is useless without faith. Because if faith is not included, God cannot be pleased. And if God is not pleased, the whole exercise is a waste. Because all things were created for his pleasure. So anything we do here, what gives it relevance is that it pleases God. And the only basis by which our actions can please God is because it is done in faith. So before you do anything, make sure you have faith. That's why the moment we got born again, we were saved by faith, and a measure of faith was dealt to us. So that everyone must operate by faith. Number two, this realm, Hebrews 11:3, he said it was framed by the principle of faith. Through faith, we understand that the walls were created. That means this realm operates by faith. So if you don't live by faith, you'll be defeated in this realm. And as you study this faith subject, I know, sir, let me try some things. I know you are a faith giant. Anybody who went to Oropko. So if anything is wrong here, correct me at the back. I want to learn. There are two broad dimensions. The first broad dimension of faith is the Abrahamic dimension. And the second dimension is the faith of the Son of God. These are the two modalities for the workings of faith. The Abrahamic dimension necessitates that you trust in God and God does the work. That's how the patriarchs of old lived. So they look up to God and God does the work. It was Abraham that found it. In Romans 4 from verse 1, he said, what did Abraham our father according to the flesh found? And as he read down, he said, he believed God. It was counted to him for righteousness. And we saw where that happened. In Genesis 15 verse 5 and 6, he brought him out and told him, look at the stars. If you can count them, that's how your descendants will be. And he said, Abraham believed God. And it was counted to him for righteousness. So when Abraham needed a child, the Bible said he didn't consider his body now dead. Neither did he consider the deadness of Sarah's womb. He said, but he was strong in faith. What did he do? He didn't confront his problem. He faced God. So the Abrahamic order is, call on God, God answers. And that is beautiful. But when Jesus came, he now upgraded it. You are not designed to always call on God. You can fellowship with God. He said, but when you have a problem, talk to the problem. Don't talk to God. Abraham mentored a generation to talk to God about the problem. Now God wants you to face the problem. So he said, if you confront a mountain, leave God out of the matter. He said, you say to this mountain, why? Something has happened. In the days of Abraham, God is in heaven. And heaven alone. Now, God is not only in heaven, God is in you. So in the God, in the faith of the Son of God, you will release God from your spirit. And so you see that it's a growth in spiritual dominion. Because your son, for example, if your son wants to eat, you will give him food when he's five. If he wee-wees, you will clean him up. If he's going to school, you will give him money. You will drop him off. But when he becomes 30, if he wants to eat, you say, go and buy it. And if there's food, go and cook. And if he wee-wees where he shouldn't, it's either he ends in the psychiatric or he ends in the guard room. But one way or the other, he must end somewhere. Because now you expect him to be able to use what he has received from you. So in the equation of triumphant living, we grow in faith. Now look at the way Jesus walked this matter. Jesus shows up in a wedding and they say the wine is finished. Because the life of Jesus is a way of mentoring us who are born again. Because he needs us to walk like him. And he shows up in the wedding and the mother comes to him and said, the wine is finished. He said, woman, it's not yet my time. And the mother turns to the people and says, whatever he tells you to do, do. And Jesus looks at them. You think Jesus will go and start praying. He said, fill the empty jars. They filled it. He said, draw from it. You think he'll say, taste it. You wouldn't you take precaution? You think, you say, okay, for modesty's sake, give me, let me taste first. He now says, take it to the governor of the feast. You look at him and say, Gov what? What if it's not wine? This container is where they wash leg and hand. This water, number one, is not hygienic. And you want me to take to him? What if he drinks and I go to jail? I can imagine what the servants were doing. But the woman that spoke to them is a respected woman. Whatever he tells you to do, do. And they carry it and give the governor, and they are shaking. And the governor now drinks and say, why did they keep the best wine for the last? Only God knows the face of that servant. The face would have dropped. What happened here? He knew that God, he said, it pleased the Father that the fullness of the Godhead should dwell in him bodily. The fullness. So he knew. It's what you call it that it is. That's how the faith of the Son of God works. Whatever you call it, that is what it is. And so he operated that level of dominion. That's triumphant living. You must grow your faith to a level where whatever you call it, that's what it is. That's why God told Abraham, you are the father of nations. This man has not one son. But whatever you call it, that's what it is. You want to walk in dominion, you must become a master of faith. You must grow your faith until circumstances respond to what you say. But you see, for you to operate here, there are four things. Number one, you must work on what you see and hear. Because the law of visualization must take its force. You are a product of your processing. What you see and what you hear is who you are. So if you hear fear, you hear failure, you see it, you will process it into your manifestation. This is why many are not operating like this. So if we want to walk triumphantly, we must learn how to lock our ear gates and our eye gates. See, a Christian should not hear and see everything. You only hear and see what edifies. Because you are training your spirit. There is a power that your spirit must release at all times. Because your dominion is tied to it. They say God is able to do, Ephesians 3:20, exceeding abundantly above all you ask or think, according to the power that is at work on your inside. Many of us have not allowed that power to go to work. Because what we see and hear immobilizes that power. He said in Proverbs chapter 4 verse 20. How to begin to awaken that power. He said, my son, attend to my words. Incline thy ears unto my saying. He went further to verse 21. He said, put them in the midst of thy heart. They are life to them that find them. And health to all their flesh. He said, guard your heart with all diligence. Out of it are the issues of life. I'm telling you, in addition to prophecy, in addition to laying on of hands, you must work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Some person's faith is rusty. That's why there's no manifestation in their lives. Every one of us sitting here is supposed to be a sign and a wonder to our generation. I'm telling you, this is no longer something for prophets, for judges. We are in a new era. We are in a new generation. Every one of us carry Christ, and every one of us should manifest the glory of God. But the protocol is tied to the operation of faith. But our faith is rusty. What are you seeing? What are you hearing? You want to be a leader? You don't know any example in scripture that grew into global relevance. How can you be a leader? You know nothing about Nehemiah. You know nothing about Daniel. You know nothing about Esther. You know nothing about Deborah. And you want to be a leader. What then is inspiring you? Somebody say he wants to be a leader. Meanwhile, Kim Kardashian is her role model. And he comes to church on Sunday. When they say prayer, he lifts his hand. Honestly, he lifts his hand. He loves God. She loves God. But unfortunately, the mind is garbage. And so the power within cannot work.
The power is there,
but it's dormant. What is on your inside, if it manifests, the world can explode. He said it's the same power that rose Jesus from the dead that dwells on our inside. That power. So even if it's death, you can command it to go back. How come we now appear helpless? Because that power is not at work. The operation of faith is still deadened by what we see and by what we hear. If you want faith to come alive, you must doctor what you hear and what you see, because that is what wakes you up. I am a preacher, so I know what I see. If I'm going for a miracle service, I gather the video clips after meditating on healing scriptures and praying to receive a word for the meeting. Sometimes I go as far back as Jacko. And the man enters a healing service. Somebody has cancer. He's not even praying. He says, come, let's look at it. Is it cancer you are talking about like that? And the person shows up. He says, now, Father, in the name of Jesus. As he's praying, he says, oh, look at it. Look at it. Cancer is out. Cancer. I go back and say, I didn't pray enough. Is it the cancer that I'm battling with and sweating that somebody handled so casually? What do you mean? I go as far back as A.A. Allen. They brought a child. The leg was like rubber. He said, stretch your hands in this direction. Right now, the Lord's going to heal him. Sir, there's no bone there. Pray this prayer in a safe place. Pray this prayer in a safe place. He said, come on, stretch your hands. Very authoritative. Stretch your, oh, thank you, Father. It's done. Okay, come on, boy. Come on, come on. And the rubber leg suddenly becomes strong. And the child begins to walk. I said, what? Manta. Barakata sudak. Veraki azuzuzu. Baradina sagata. So when I go to my own service, sometimes I become drunk. And I forget for a second. I think me too, I'm Jacko. I think me too, I'm A.A. Allen. And when I'm preaching, after a while, when the anointing is there, I say, who is sick here? Stand up, you are healed. You don't need prayer. Yeah. Veraki atua pakatoa. Verira duasta fecatinos. You are joking? He said, follow after them who through faith and patience obtain the promise. We will not stop until we too wrought valiantly in battle. Sometimes I'm going, why do you think sometimes I wear Sanchos? I'm going for healing. And I see Pastor Chris, he shows up with white suit, strolling. Is it a place where you are coming to deal with something that is risky, that you are wearing white suit for? Get up, get up, get up. My God. Is this how this thing works? It must happen in my own life. I will not stop. So as I'm praying, I'm visualizing in the spirit. I'm visualizing. And sometimes Jaco passes, or a robot passes, A.A. Allen passes, Pastor Chris passes, and I'm still praying. After a while, scripture start being animated. He said, when the evening was come, they brought all that were sick, that he might touch them. And he said, he touched them and rebuked sickness and healed them with his word. And me too, my meeting becomes evening. And I show up, it must happen. It must happen. Because Paul said, according as it is written. He said, they believe and have spoken. We having the same spirit of faith. The same spirit of faith. Not a different spirit. The same spirit of faith. We believe and therefore we speak. You are a music minister. Have you heard of Fanny Crosby? The blind woman that sang 8,000 hymns. Today they are singing her hymns. Hymns that never die. Anywhere you sing it, there's an anointing. If you like, go to a church where there are no instruments. As you leave the hymn, the presence comes down. And then you sing song. After 5 years, it vanishes. No way. If there is a God in them that made them rot that level of impact, that God must manifest in my own life. Because if it doesn't, we will not live here. This world will not end until we manifest God. That's how faith works. You become aggressive. You see it, you hear it. And you know what? When you have heard it, then you go to the second level. You start talking it. Because faith talks. They can't be in faith and keep quiet. In Romans 10:6, it said, the righteousness that is of faith speaketh on this wise. If there is faith, there must be speaking. Because it's when you speak that you direct the power. So So the power that is now boiling on your inside, based on what you've seen and heard, you start channeling it. You start talking it. You start releasing it. It may not appear yet, but keep talking. It said, when your cloud be full of rain, it must empty itself upon the earth. You stand up, you say, this hospital will be the best in the world. This business, we must supply customers in England. We must supply customers in America. We must supply customers in Dubai. It's not only in Dubai they to buy things. They will come from Dubai to buy from here. It looks like caricature. Keep talking. What you are doing is that you are building your cloud. When your cloud is saturated, the rain that will pour down. Aya, if you don't have enough container, it will become a flood. Talk until you saturate your realm. And when you are done talking, take action. Because faith takes action. In James 2:19, it said that believers that there's only one God. It said that doeth well. The devil also believes and trembles. He said, but oh ye vain man, faith without works is dead. In verse 26, he said, as the body without the spirit is dead. He says, so also faith without works is dead. When you talk about the business, go and start the business. When you talk about healing, go and pray for the sick. He will say, you gather people in stadium, go and start evangelism. Anything you say, take corresponding action. Because if you don't take action, the Lord will not walk with you. He said in Mark 16:20, he said, and they went. And the Lord walking with them, confirming the word with signs and wonders following. It's when you go that God walks with you. And so anybody who wants to be triumphant by faith must learn how to go out. Listen, inaction will not take you anywhere. Be sufficiently mobilized. The angels are waiting for you to walk. God is waiting for you to walk. As you step out, something will happen. You will not be put to shame. He said they looked up to him. Their faces were radiant. They were not ashamed. You can't go out and God does not go with you. And as you start going out, you now pay the price to condition your atmosphere. Don't allow anything to choke your atmosphere. Make sure your conscience is pure. He said, holding faith and a good conscience, which some having put away concerning faith, have shipwrecked their faith. Offense will come, remove it. When you start, they say, look at him. He's a proud person. He thinks, leave them alone. Let them be talking. Remove the offense. Don't respond. If you start responding, your life becomes a reaction. And you are too important to leave a reaction. You are on a course. God has written it before the foundation of the world. You are following your script. Remove the bitterness. In fact, train yourself to love your enemies. He said, faith worketh by love. Keep that atmosphere of love. As the love is growing, the faith is growing. As purity is growing, the faith is growing. And don't stop there. Add prayer to it. He said, whatsoever ye believe. He said, when you pray, if you ask, you will receive it. So add prayer to the atmosphere. And as you are building that atmosphere, you are sustaining it. Your manifestation is becoming bigger. It's becoming bigger. After a while, your neighbors will become aware. After a while, your fame will go abroad. After a while, the kings will start coming. After a while, the doors of nations will start opening. And your life start moving from one level of glory to another level of glory. And you are just basking in triumph. You are just basking in glory. And they say, how is it happening? You say, it is the manifestation of the faith of the Son of God. It's the manifestation of the faith of the Son of God. This is how we were designed to live. He said, the just that live by faith. A point will come, you will do some things, they will look at you and say, but you are a woman. You say, it's not gender sensitive. It is faith. It is faith sensitive. How can you be doing this? You are only a woman. It's not gender sensitive. It is faith sensitive. They look at you and say, how old are you? You are too young. It is not age sensitive. It's faith sensitive. They look at you and say, but you are a Nigerian. You are a black man. It is not race sensitive. It is faith sensitive. Wherever you are, whoever you are, whatever gender you are, if it is faith, it will work.
Hooray, forever.
Fire. Can you pray in the Holy Ghost?
To your